Okay, well, I'm gonna blow through a lot of material, so I'm gonna go ahead and cut and paste some resources into the chat box, just some fact sheets that I'm gonna reference here. I have a note from Cheryl Smith, who is our plant pathologist here in New Hampshire. She can't make it tonight, but she wants to remind everybody that scab risk is still high. Especially since we are expecting some rains the end of this week. Usually the last ascospores released will occur in the first rain after petal fall. It's been really dry, so she's cautioning everybody to keep protectants on through the next two rainy periods. I see that Trevor Hardy is out protecting his trees right now. Scout for scab, scout for fire blight strikes. If found, remove by the ugly cut method during dry weather, remove prunings from orchard, are under trees and home gardens. Just looking at the risk of summer diseases for right now, that's low. It's just been too dry to accumulate those hours of wetness after petal fall for the summer diseases. Let's see, what did I want to talk about today as far as insect pests? I'm New Hampshire's entomologist. I'm going to share my screen. And oh, guys, I have a video. I think you're going to like this. Well, maybe not. Wanted to talk about internal feeders, internal caterpillars, and I found this awesome video of this. This is a codling moth egg that was laid on an apple fruit. You can see that little larvae developing inside. Look how cute it is. These moths typically will lay their eggs near fruit, so sometimes this will be on the leaves next to fruit. They'll hatch out and they'll crawl over to the fruit and start burrowing in. So just to remind you where we are in the season right now, the parent of this baby will be flying around, meeting somebody special, starting a family and laying these eggs. Typically, the best way to time sprays is to time sprays from your biofix. So you would be using pheromones to trap moths as soon as you have a consistent trapping, that's your biofix. If you're using products that target the eggs, like Ryman, Intrepid, Esteem, you would time that from 150 growing degree days from your biofix. If you're using materials that target these larvae, these adorable larvae, you would be using 250 to 360 degree days to time good efficacy for getting that material out during that short window of time between hatch and when it is chewing into that fruit. So you can see how much material it ate before it burrowed into the fruit. This is many instars later, once it's gotten down to the carpel. And then here's a nice shot of, now that it's gone through that, it's dropped to the ground or it's burrowed into the bark and it's pupating there. And here's your next generation emerging from that pupal form. And that will be the one that's causing the damage. So of course the damage at harvest is in the second and third generations, but you get your best control if you target the first generation, which is occurring now in orchards. So I just think that's so amazing. Really good videos. So talking about internal feeders in general, most of us are affected by codling moth. However, a few of us will be affected by oriental fruit moth. So I've included some fact sheets for both of those. There's three pretty easy ways to distinguish between codling moth and oriental fruit moth. One is the super, super nerdy way, that the actual larvae has what we call an anal comb on its rear end there. You really need to get down with a microscope to look at that. It's kind of RC level stuff. A couple other ways to distinguish between codling moth and oriental fruit moth. A trick that George taught us, I think it came from George, is that if you're seeing that injury in peaches as well as apple, chances are good it might be oriental fruit moth instead of codling moth that's causing your problem. The big difference between these two species from a management point of view is that oriental fruit moth, the first generation, flies a little bit earlier than codling moth. So if you're seeing injury a little bit earlier in fruit, it might be oriental fruit moth. It probably isn't, but good thing is that the mating disruption ties that you can put out, those would have gone out before bloom. Those are effective for codling moth and oriental fruit moth. a couple comments about some materials that you'd be targeting. I know I've mentioned a couple that were known as ovicidal and some that were known as larvicidal. You'll notice that this is the tree fruit guide. Lots and lots of products say must be ingested in order to be effective, most active when ingested. So that's why that timing is really important, that it be on the plant material during that small period of time where the larvae are chewing into the surface. So products like Entrust, that really needs to be ingested for it to be effective in controlling those larvae. Products like Madex, Sidex, these are very specific to codling moth. A couple other products I wanted to mention, Altacor, XRL, Vertiprin, and Belt. These are all diamides and they will all have efficacy, pretty good efficacy on codling moth. So if you're looking for new rotational materials, those will all do the trick for codling moth. A couple other things. I mean, there's lots of other things that you can rotate in. Now is the time of year that peach tree borer is starting to fly. Lesser peach tree borer will definitely start flying before peach tree borer. The big difference between these two species is lesser peach tree borer tends to like to lay its eggs higher in the scaffold, where peach tree borer likes to lay its eggs lower, closer to the ground. So it will be looking for wounds and cuts in the side of the trunk. This is why being very careful about mowing and other things that cause wounding in trunks is an important part of avoiding good oviposition habitat for these groups. There are some herbicides that can also cause injury in trunks that might be making those trunks more attractive to egg laying for these species. Again, the standard treatment for this is trunk applications of Lorsban. If you look at the New England guide for materials other than Lorsban, when we finally do lose Lorsban because they're going to stop manufacturing it, there's a huge list of pyrethroids. All of these products, these 3A products, are pyrethroids. In order to get the same control you get from one application of Lorsban, you really have to be applying maybe 3 times throughout the season to cover that full flight of lesser peach tree borer and peach tree borer during that time where they're laying eggs on your trees. So to keep in mind, multiple applications. We have some plans to look a little bit deeper into some of these kind of semi-systemic materials that move into the tree, whether or not they provide as much control as that one treatment of Lorsban with fewer applications. Stay tuned for that. Another thing to keep in mind this time of year, woolly apple aphid is a kind of sporadic rare pest. In general, biocontrol of woolly apple aphid will take care of it, but sometimes things get out of whack. Sometimes you'll have problems. You'd be scouting the inner canopy right now for these groups and look at that fact sheet to see what you're looking for. Comstock mealybug is another thing. This time of year, you might start putting tape on your scaffolding if you're trying to time sprays for that. For these two insects, they're different. They have really different life cycles, and there's going to be different timing. However, they're both hard to control for the same reason. They produce this waxy covering, so sprays will have a harder time penetrating to get to those insects and get really good control. So we really recommend whatever you do use to include a horticultural oil or a surfactant like an LI-700 or a Regulade to make sure that that material is getting where it needs to go to do the business. Looking at products that are registered, oh, here for Comstock mealybug, a sale is highly rated. Centaur, this is an interesting one. This is an insect growth regulator. And it is selective for these groups of insects. So for Comstock mealybug, aphids, things like that, and it won't touch your beneficials. So you won't have problems with flaring other aphid species. Portal is a broad spectrum medi insecticide. So this is a miticide and an insecticide. Movento is highly rated. Movento is spirotetramat. It also has some translaminar activity. So that material is entering the plant. And when it comes to these piercing, sucking insects, they're hard to control. Getting a little bit of that material into the plant where they're feeding is really helpful. So if these are insects that are in your life and you're battling with them, consider some new products. All right, with that, Jeremy, I'm gonna hand it over to you.
Okay, and George, I think you're actually the one with the presentation, so I'm going to ask you if you'll share your screen.
Yep.
All right. So, let's see, George, can you, oh, there we go. Thank you.
Is it up?
Yep. All right, so one of the things we've been trying to do at most of our meetings is kind of keep growers updated on COVID-related agricultural updates. And so tonight, it was important really to show kind of what some of the programs, the assistance programs that maybe some funding attached to are, and give you places to learn more about them and give you a brief update on them. So. The one right now that's pretty time sensitive is it's being called the New Hampshire Agriculture COVID-19 Relief Program. This is for specialty crop producers. And so this is being run through the New Hampshire Department of Ag and really aimed at helping growers recover economic losses as incurred as a result of COVID-19. The main focus is gonna be for increased costs related to labor or for personal protective equipment, PPE. So if you have incurred increased expenses related to either of those, then this may very well apply to you. Okay, next slide, George. This is also help cover losses for maple operations. This is mainly due to the fact that Maple Weekend was heavily impacted by this. And, you know, it's recognized that maple producers lost quite a few opportunities for sale during that time. Let's see, so the relief funding payments will be made by December 30th, 2020, and that's mainly because that's when the funding expires, so it needs to be spent by that time. This is for producers who gross revenues of $50,000 or more in 2019. So you would be eligible for this program if you fell into that category. In New Hampshire, we estimate that to be around 400 farms. And really the way that was looked at was that if we went much below that, it was going to be a pretty small amount of money based on a percentage of those sales. And so they set that number of 50,000. And so what that looks like is around $3,750 per farm on average that would be available. There's a really great guidance sheet at the address, the link listed there, where that's really clear. Okay, George. All right, so for this one, registration opened up a couple of days ago on Monday, and registration ends on June 22nd at midnight. So need to get that initial, and that's kind of a pre-application. So you submit that application, that gets your foot in the door, and then basically you would apply quarterly for losses is the way that this is going to work. So that's the important deadline is June 22nd. You can get to the application right through the Department of Ag's website. And it's also, the link is listed here below, but don't miss that date if you're planning to apply. Okay, George? All right, so then there are other programs you probably have heard something about. There's the Economic Injury Disaster Loan Program, or EIDL. And so this is also geared at losses of sales or lost revenues. So this program currently is open and available only for agricultural producers right now. It's the only sector that they're accepting applications from. So that is open right now. There's the website to go to learn more. And then also the Paycheck Protection Program is another potential option to help with retaining employees basically through kind of challenging financial times. So that's another option. George? Okay, and then we are coming up on CFAP, or this Coronavirus Food Assistance Program, that's going to be administered through Farm Service Agency. That started on the 26th that they started accepting applications. So that's still open and available to apply. Here's the website for more information. And then George, and then so to kind of summarize all of this, there's going to be a webinar on Monday, this coming Monday, June 15th, 7 o'clock. So our ag business team is really the ones who are spearheading and wrangling all this information as it comes in, and making sure that we're getting it on time. So they're going to do a webinar. They're going to have representatives from all of these different agencies that are handling these programs, give you an update, explain the process, answer questions. And so there's the Zoom link here at the bottom that's available. And so that is going to be a really good place to go to make sure you're up to date on all of that. So don't forget, that's Monday at 7. Okay, and the last thing that I wanted to mention is, so this is an effort between Cooperative Extension, Olivia Saunders is our field specialist in Carroll County that's been kind of spearheading this for us, American Farm Bureau and New Hampshire Farm Bureau. You know, we've kind of recognized the need to make sure that we're acknowledging farmer mental health and that, you know, this is a challenging time for many. And so this is a campaign that they're doing, kind of a push basically just to encourage farmers and service providers just to check in with each other regularly. Just pick up the phone if there's somebody you haven't talked to in a while. Call them up, let them know you're caring about them, that you're thinking about them, that you're here to help, hope they're doing okay. And it's something that all of us can do. There's a social media push, and it's they're using the hashtag Farming Together. Just recognizing that we want to kind of destigmatize this thing of farmer mental health and let folks know it's okay to reach out, ask for help, there are resources there. So just want to encourage folks to do that and support each other during this time, and know that we're with Extension, we're all here to support you as well.